Good morning, Springdale. Welcome to worship. We also welcome any and all of you who are visiting our congregation here in rural Sioux Falls. Glad to be united in worship. It is the third Sunday of Advent, and our theme for Advent is Prepare the Way of the Lord, to be ready for God to come with new life and peace and hope. In the Northern Hemisphere, we experience this marvelous irony in Advent that as the world gets darker, the days are shorter as December deepens. The light of our Advent candles becomes brighter. We are closer to God's coming. We hope that that spirit invigorates you and excites you for the season and prepares you spiritually for all that is to come in our life together. We begin worship now with the invocation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. The hymn is number 279, O Little Town of Bethlehem. We'll sing verses 1 and 4. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit is with us all. Amen. The shortness of the days is not the only darkness that Advent explores. We are aware that there are things that in us that resist God's coming. We describe them as shadows, as darkness, or as sin. A penitential season is the freedom to admit that darkness, to believe that God comes even there to make us new. We begin our confession in silence, and then we will pray together. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Our song of Advent is Prepare the Way of the Lord from Godspell. pray the prayer of the day together. God, we thank and praise you for the life you call Springdale Lutheran Church. We thank you for 150 years of ministry. We shudder to remember the day the church burned. We ache for those who are no longer part of our fellowship. We hear your call from John the Baptist to return to you, that you call us to rise again, live again, serve again. In Jesus' name, amen. We'll hear the scripture.
The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They shall be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, to display his glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall rise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. Strangers shall stand and feed your flocks, but you shall be called priests of the Lord. You shall be named ministers of our God. You shall enjoy the wealth of the nations, and in the riches you shall glory, because their shame was double, and dishonor was proclaimed as their lot. Therefore they shall possess a double portion. Everlasting joy shall be theirs. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their recompense, and I will make everlasting covenant with them.
When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue with shouts of joy. And then it was among the nations. The Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we rejoiced. Restore our righteousness, O Lord, like the watercourses in Negev. May those who sorrow in tears weep with shouts of joy, those who go out weeping, bearing with the seed of sowing, shall come home with shouts of joy and carrying their sheaves.
Thank you, Evelyn and Jocelyn. The Gospel for the third Sunday of Advent is from Matthew chapter 3. In those days, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness of Judea proclaiming, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is the one of whom the prophet Isaiah spoke when he said, "The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight." Now John wore clothing of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Then the people of Jerusalem and all Judea were going out to him, and all the region along the Jordan, and they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. But when John saw how many Pharisees and Sadducees coming for baptism, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee the wrath to come? Bear fruit worthy of repentance. Do not presume to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our ancestor.' For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now, the axe is lying at the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but one is coming who is more powerful than I. I am not worthy to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor and will gather his wheat into the granary, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." The gospel of our Lord. Thanks be to God. We have a children's sermon this morning, and we even have children to help me. I'm going to try to get close enough. See, Evelyn, if you'll hold it, we'll see close enough so that we can get the pictures for you to see who are worshiping at home. We'll come a little closer. A little closer yet. This is the book, The Giving Tree by Shel Silverstein. It has a lot to say about our theme for Advent. Once there was a tree, and she loved a little boy. And every day the boy would come, and he would gather her leaves and make them into crowns and play king of the forest. He would climb up her trunk and would swing from her branches and eat apples. And they would play hide and go seek. And when he was tired, he would sleep in her shade. And the boy loved the tree very much, and the tree was happy. But time went by, and the boy grew older, and the tree was often alone. Then one day the boy came to the tree and said, And the tree said, "Come, boy, come and climb up my trunk and swing from my branches and eat apples and play in my shade and be happy." "I'm too big to climb and play," said the boy. "I want to buy things and have fun. I want some money. Can you give me some money?" "I'm sorry," said the tree, "but I have no money. I have some leaves and apples. Take my apples, boy, and sell them in the city. Then you will have money and you will be happy." And so the boy climbed up the tree and gathered her apples and carried them away, and the tree was happy. But the boy stayed away for a long time, and the tree was sad. And then one day the boy came back, and the tree shook with joy and said, "Come, boy, climb up my trunk, swing from my branches and be happy." "I'm too busy to climb trees," said the boy. "I want a house to keep me warm," he said. "I want a wife and I want children. So I need a house. Can you give me a house?" "I have no house," said the tree. "The forest is my house. But you may cut off my branches and build a house, and you will be happy." And so the boy cut off her branches and carried them away, and he built his house, and the tree was happy. But the boy stayed away for a long time, and when he came back, the tree was so happy she could hardly speak. "Come, boy," she whispered, "come and play." "I'm too old and sad to play," said the boy. "I want a boat that will take me far away from here. Can you give me a boat?" "Cut down my trunk and make a boat," said the tree. "Then you can sail away and be happy." And so the boy cut down her trunk, made a boat, and sailed away. And the tree was happy, but not really. And after a long time, the boy came back again. "I'm sorry, boy," said the tree, "but I have nothing left to give you. My apples are gone." "My teeth are too weak for apples," said the boy. "My branches are gone," said the tree. "You cannot swing in them. I'm too old to swing on branches," said the boy. "My trunk is gone," said the tree. "You cannot climb. I'm too tired to climb," said the boy. "I am sorry," sighed the tree. "I wish I could give you something, but I have nothing left. I'm just an old stump. I am sorry." "I don't need very much now," said the boy. "Just a quiet place to sit and rest. I am very tired." "Well," said the tree, straightening herself up as much as she could, "well, an old stump is good for sitting and resting. Come, boy, sit down. Sit down and rest." And the boy did. And the tree was happy. What do you think the story was about, Evelyn and Jocelyn? It's about giving, isn't it? And it's about different gifts for different times and how God can use even very hard gifts to make something good. I hope you like the story, and I hope you think about it a lot. Thanks for being in church today. The axe is laid to the root of the tree, John the Baptist says. That's a very different image in this series. Dorothy Nelson was a potter who lived in Brookings. For those of you who knew Ed Nervig, you'll be interested in knowing she was his sister. And she grew up wanting to be a pastor. In her lifetime, that door was not open for her. So at age 50, she became a potter. Both Isaiah and Jeremiah describe God as a potter. They emphasize that the potter makes of the clay what the potter wishes. As we talked about last week, lots of forces shape our lives and our churches. The motto of the ELCA is God's work, our hands. God is the potter whose hands use ours to shape who we are and how we shape the world. Dorothy was energetic and fun, and her pottery is beautiful. I brought a few samples this morning. She would often talk about how some of her pots are functional, like this casserole, and how some of her pots were ornamental, strictly for beauty and enjoyment, like this doll. And some of them are both functional and beautiful, like this coffee cup. What's more functional and beautiful for Norwegians than coffee? Dorothy was a guest in one of our congregations to teach us about how pottery images God's work with us. One of the first things Dorothy taught us was the importance of clay being perfectly centered on the potter's wheel. I think of Jesus' command for us to love our neighbors as ourselves. It's a both and kind of tension. We can't just love others, but we oughtn't just love it. We get off balance either way. That tension keeps us centered. Dorothy demonstrated how as a pot got taller, if it got off center, like if we only think about ourselves or if we only think about others, the potter couldn't do a thing with it. It was the most dramatic moment in her whole series. She held up a pot and said, "If it is off-centered like this, there is only one thing the potter can do." And she took her hand and smashed it. Shards of clay flew in every direction. She was quiet for a moment to let that soak in. And then she quietly walked around the chancel, picking up pieces of clay, and calmly explained the good news. If the bad news is that off-centered, God can do nothing with us, the good news is being smashed is not the end of the story. For the potter and for us, the potter moistens the clay again and starts over. Someone has said that whoever says this is the end of the story is not the author of the story. The smashing looked like the end of the potter's story, but it wasn't. So it may be helpful to think about Advent as pregnancy. There is growth in and through all of pregnancy, but at the end, there is this dramatic ending. But it's not the end of the story. It's the beginning of the whole story of pregnancy is about. It's the beginning of a life. Advent is our pregnant waiting for Jesus to be born anew. Whoever says the end of the story is not the author of the story. When the Chinese write their word for crisis, they use two characters. One is danger, and the other is opportunity. Danger is that it feels like the end. The opportunity is the way God makes it a new beginning. When John the Baptist says the axe is laid to the root of the tree, it sounds very much like an ending. Curtains, death, condemnation, over, period. But John the Baptist is not the end of the story. He is its beginning. He is preaching repentance, preparing, prepare to begin. Repentance is turning. Turn toward others, turn toward your own brokenness, and turn toward God, who can spin the story in a new way. Even if it feels like an ending, God promises a new beginning. Bear fruit that befits repentance, John says. Today we face the hard truth that pruning serves fruitfulness. Last week, Jesus gave the fig tree some manure and another year in hopes that it would be fruitful. Common wisdom says, if a tree is diseased, it needs to go for the sake of other trees. It is a severe mercy, but an important truth. But in Jesus' name, I'm thankful to assure you, this is not the end of the story. What obstacles in your life need to be cut in Springdale's life? What roots need to be severed so that we can be new? And when have you experienced a crashing only to learn more about God's new beginnings? The remembering of a church's history must speak of these times too. The time Springdale may have felt leveled. When the text speaks of fire, we of course think of the day the first Springdale building burned. As we focus on the story of our church this year, I hope we can recover some of that story or bring our imagination to it. What do you suppose helped the congregation know the tragedy could become a new beginning? I don't know how it was at Springdale, but many immigrant congregations faced a crisis, danger, and opportunity when they switched from worshiping in their immigrant language to English. It was a crisis. Giving up the language was danger more than opportunity, according to many. I've wondered if this year we should read Giants in the Earth. Ole Rovag, the author of the story, set it up by Gerritsen, not far from here. and he minces no words about what the immigrants felt they had lost, what had been cut from them, convinces us this was a wrenching, traumatic experience. Axes laid to the root of trees again and again and again. In Rovog's book, the young Lutheran congregation split over worshiping in English. Repentance is about turning to life, but no one says it's easy. Lyle Schaller was a church growth guru in the 20th century. He said churches need only one question to grow. It is the question, where do you hurt? Where do you hurt as individuals? Where do we hurt as a congregation? The power of the gospel is to meet us there and to help us grow, to help us grow and heal and serve from wounded places. When we have failed, we may learn to be receptive, truthful, compassionate, and honest about human limitations. Maybe that's all God wants from us from the start. One of the things that has impressed me about Springdale is the freedom folks feel here to tell stories of their brokenness. You clearly face it. You face it honestly, and you face it together. The times life collapses, awareness of addiction, broken relationships, broken families, financial crises. And we learn in these places that these are where God makes a new beginning. If Advent is about preparing us for God making new beginnings, we begin by speaking by where life and newness is most needed. So John the Baptist comes swinging an axe, calling us out of presumption and calling us toward a fruitfulness maybe we can't even imagine. Can't even imagine that it will come from our broken places. This speaks not only to us as individuals, it speaks to us as a society. I want to believe that the United States is founded on all people are created equal, and liberty and justice for all, the language of our founding documents. I don't just want to believe this. I believe these are our deepest roots. But again this year, we become aware of evidence that the United States is also built on stolen land and slavery. It's a good thing our Constitution says we seek to form a more perfect union. United States has been trying since the Civil War in 1860 to build a union where all people are equal. Again, since the Civil Rights in 1960, and again, even now. My son-in-law is writing his PhD dissertation on this mystery, that the vast majority of Americans do not believe that people of color are inferior, and yet disparity and discrepancies remain. He's probing the gospel for what we can learn, for how to be new, how to cut away those roots that diminish people and help us all rise together. His project, as we hear him talk about it, reflects exactly what John the Baptist is about, naming the sin, cutting it away, and turning us to God who will raise us anew. The story of people and churches and countries is not about being perfect, but about repenting. The story of Advent is not merely about light. It is about darkness and the power of light to come to the darkness to help us all rise as with more goodness, more justice, more love. One of the things I'm thinking about concretely is learning to see things from another's point of view. There's all this talk about polarizing and partisanship as if one branch could have it all. The tree in church, in our country, in our families, needs all of us. Even before Isaiah and Jeremiah said it, the book of Genesis says, God is a potter, kneeling over clay to fashion a creature in God's own image, breathing the breath of life, and then preparing them for the day God comes as a human being in Jesus to pick up the shattered pieces of broken clay and make them new. Prepare to be new, dear Springdale. Advent is the season to prepare us for this coming. Amen. We sing the hymn about John the Baptist, On Jordan's Bank, the Baptist's Cry, number 249, verses 1, 2, and 4. We are united in faith, and the Apostles' Creed summarizes all the gifts God gives us to make God's world new. We confess it together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We're united now in prayer.
God, thank you for Advent. Help us prepare for your coming by turning us to you for all that we need. Turn us to you today for a new beginning. Turn us to you for life. Lord, in your mercy, your prayer. God, thank you for making every day a new beginning. We pray for all people facing disasters to hear your promise of new life. We pray it especially for people who have lost their homes to fires in the West or have lost their crops to hurricanes. Help us know how to help them start again. Lord, in your mercy, your prayer. God, thank you for healing. Today, we especially pray for Blake, Judy, Robin, Jerry, Eileen, Scott, Penny, May Lou, Sheila, Nancy, Skylar, Dwayne, Davis, Julie, Dorothy, Jason, and Betty Lou. We pray for a vaccine for COVID-19 and for healing for who all are sick or in grief. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, thank you for our country and for the vision and hope of liberty and justice for all. Teach us how to live toward the peace and justice you want for your people and for your world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, thank you for Springdale. Thank you for all the gifts of fellowship and support we receive from each other. And thank you for your call to serve. As we celebrate 150 years of ministry, help us grow in you, in faith and in sharing your love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Moment in your home to share God's peace, to focus and lean on the promise of God growing us together for peace. We're thankful for all the gifts that God has given you as a congregation and all the ways you share those gifts, both with your church and with others. We're especially thankful in this pandemic that you are faithful in your support of our congregation and its ministry. As we take a time for offering, think about your gifts and God's call to share them. Also, it's a time when you may gather a piece of bread or a cracker and some wine or grape juice, because we will be celebrating Holy Communion in this worship. Thank you for worshiping here, and thank you for your gifts. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Lord Jesus, come even to our brokenness and teach us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The body of Christ is given for you. The blood of Christ is shed for you. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ and his most precious blood strengthen and keep you in God's grace this day and always. Amen. Again, thank you for worshiping here at Springdale today. I have two announcements. One is that next week, on December 20th at 5 o'clock, we're going to gather for candlelighting and prayer here on the Churchill lot. We're trying once a month to get together live so we can see each other. We'll hear the Christmas story, sing a carol softly, probably, and be masked for safety, but also be present to one another and the Christmas gift as we light candles. So I hope all of you can come next Sunday at 5:00. We're also going to have Christmas Eve worship via YouTube this year. On December 24th, we'll post that on the YouTube channel in the morning, so it'll be available to you and your family anytime throughout Christmas Eve Day or Christmas Day, and a very important day for us to worship together. Now receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you God's peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Closing hymn is Go Tell It on the Mountain. Go in peace, serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thanks for gathering in worship today. God bless you as you prepare for God's coming this Christmas. Amen.
Every time I try to make it on my own, every time I try to stand, start to fall. And all those lonely roads that I've traveled on, there was Jesus. When the life I built came crashing to the ground, when the friends I had were nowhere to be, I couldn't see it then, but I can see it now. Well, there was Jesus. In the way, in the searching, in the healing, in the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. See you.
Jesus.
In the shadows of the alleys,
there was Jesus.
In the fire, in the floods,
there was Jesus.
Always is and always was. No, I never walked alone.
Okay, and you have the book? Okay, good. You can take the Advent calendar home too, there.